10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. 10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Windranger at your service.
Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Anti-mage.
Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Dark Seer.
Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Prepare for battle.
That's right, we're in the first game of this grand finals of the best of three between Vega Squadron and Team Secret. Of course, Capitalist joined by my friend Blitz. Blitz, last pick slaughter coming out from Vega Squadron. Definitely one of the things we want to talk about the most. Is that really the hero for Vega?
I think it just, they've had a theme throughout this tournament to just play really aggressively with their cores, and the Slardar kind of just fits into that pretty perfectly. Like, you really want to be the aggressors, and when you're playing against a Team Secret that has Weehaw playing the Windranger and the Anti-Mage, you don't want to go late game up against this, and so going for that Blink melee carry, you can kind of press the issue a lot sooner than you want, than you normally would.
Yeah, if you actually manage to get, like, the PPD was talking about, if you pick up the early Blink Dagger on the Tiny, and you can play aggressively and, you know, pick off the Windranger potentially, maybe even get a jump on an Animage as well, you could have two different Blink Initiators potentially. But I really love the Slardar as just any sort of, like, you already have your primary carry in the middle lane. You wanted to pick up something that could come online nice and early, something like Slardar or Sven works perfectly in that regard. And nice pickup by Pasha, stealing that Bounty Rune away from Weehaw, who's already going to be in a bit of a tough lane against the Tiny Wiz now without that extra 100 experience and 100 gold.
The last time we saw that Weehaw had to play against the Tiny Wisp, I can't remember what team it was, but if you remember correctly, he started like 0-4 or something.
Yeah,
like
he
that.
Died so many times.
It was Alliance, actually. He was Lina against the Tiny Wisp, and I really feel like that's one of those lessons that you learn, and hopefully it'll help him in this game, that he just has to play this game pretty passively and kind of relax. Like, the one knock I have on Weehaw as a player is that sometimes it feels like he thinks that he has to do a lot more in his lane than he normally does.
Mm-hmm. The funny thing is, they actually won that game. So if Weehaw could have actually cut down on his deaths in the early laning phase, the game would have gone easier for Team Secret. start things off, we do have a offlane Darkseer. Misery has already picked up his level 2. This is one of the big advantages when you're running a Tiny Wisp mid. You're obviously committing two different heroes to that middle lane. It means you can probably get a lot more aggressive with your offlaner. And plus, he's matched up against a Solardar. One of the big things that the analysts were talking about in the draft is you have to deal with the Darkseer here. You want to be able to pick up a hero that has, you know, can actually match up against a Darkseer well. Bloodseeker was being talked about as being one of those heroes. Solardar really isn't, in the fact that he's just going to take a lot of damage constantly and burn through regen.
Yeah, this is going to be a rough lane for him because the Darkseer can just kind of spam out the double Ion Shell, and as long as Misery plays back, he should be fine. The Disruptor is primarily focusing on just getting levels, which I think is the right idea, because if you just go down to try to trade hits with the Darkseer, I actually think that's just a waste of time. Like, the only way that you're going to kill him is get some levels on your Disruptor, wait for your Slardar to get a few levels as well, and then kind of weather the storm. But, I mean, Misery's getting a lot right now in this lane. Like, he's about to hit level 3, he's almost got the Soul Ring too, and once he has that, it kind of gives him the option of going into the jungle too. And you notice that he can stand to play this aggressively because he knows that the Slardar doesn't have mana, and he's nowhere near.
Oh, the kinetic field is actually going to catch Misery on his way out. A couple more right clicks, and Salmon Slayer might actually be able to pick up this kill. Misery, he pops the health potion, barely staying alive. He picks up the banner rune, and now goes for the deny on a Roshan, which he will not be successful. Solo holds on to that right click right until after the Roshan hits the bash, and will be able to pick up the first blood.
Maybe he could have gotten out, actually. Instead of going for the banner rune, he just went all the way up. But by going for the bounty rune, he pretty much was like, okay, I have to go for the Roshan suicide. But he had a Tango popped at 84 HP. There's actually, like, no way that he's not going to get killed there.
Oh, don't tell me Misery! He just got sent all the way back to base, just right on the cusp of that 5 seconds. But Misery now has a long trek back to the lane.
That is a really tilting move. As an offlaner, especially when you give up your first blood and then you say, okay, that's kind of expected out of this type of lane, but getting sent back too is kind of just icing on the cake for Vega. But this is a lane that I think if Misery had just kind of chilled for a little bit more, he would have been okay. Like, he was doing fine, but by contesting the stack and getting so aggressive, I almost feel like he's trying too hard to win the lane when he can just play passively and zone out the Slardar like he is right now.
Yeah, you can see the Slardar already forced into a healing self and does have a... Oh, middle lane, they're going to toss back Wii in order to try and get some extra right clicks, but he does have that win run still, though. Great body blocking from Solo, and they may actually be able to get this kill, but the turnaround on the Solo, never mind, he's dead. Toss up in the air right onto Pylai dying. No one is going to challenge him. He does have an avalanche, but it's a little too dangerous to get underneath that tier 1 tower, so no one just takes the one kill on the Windranger. Still a win for Vega.
Again, we just has to kind of respect this lane a little bit more. In the matchup where he was the Lina against Alliance's dual lane like this, it almost felt like, again, he was trying to be a little bit too over-aggressive, but this is one of the higher kill potential lanes in the game, especially with the slow. Oftentimes you can get the double toss-off, so he just kind of has to respect it a little bit more, play back a little bit, and let the natural hero mobility kind of work in his favor. Like, spam out your power shot. If they try to get close, use the wind run. You don't necessarily have to be this close like he is right now.
Yep, gonna get almost comboed. The toss will land on him. Nice shackle shot. No one will take a little bit of damage for his trouble, but he's very clearly gonna be okay with the bottle on Solo. Plus, he has another 10 magic stick charges. He's got a lot of extra regen.
I'd really like to see Weehawk kind of play back now. They've got the combo up again. The Tiny's just getting a ton of levels. He has to be really careful now not to die because it would open up so much space on the map. That means they don't have to devote anything to this mid lane. They can kind of just focus more on trying to shut down Misery. And that would just be two lanes won for Vega.
Yeah, plus you know that the Tiny's going to go back and clear through those stacks pretty soon. And that's the time where you can play maybe a little bit more forward. Maybe throw out a power shot towards that hard camp and just see what you can steal. But there's definitely going to be no stealing opportunities, really, for Secret. No aggressive five-man into the Radiant Jungle. That's used to be kind of theorized. We would see teams that were so reliant on those stacks, you would see some sort of forward position to try and interrupt that. But it seems like the Radiant Jungle is just too secure for people to make those kind of invasions this early on into the game.
You also don't have the lineup for it. Like, if it was any other carry, let's say a Gyrocopter, for sure you could make them move in. Because just with your low cooldown rocket, barrage, and your cooldown, you can make that excursion pretty easily. But when you're playing as like a Windranger and an Anti-Mage, this is kind of a passive lineup in general. Like, you're just hoping that people overextend and you can win the late game team fights with your Elder Titan Darkseer.
Misery does have to play a bit careful because we do have that level 2 glimpse ready to go. for the Disruptor, and obviously the offensive power of the Slardar actually makes for a decent killing combo.
Yeah, it's more just though that Pasha is constantly low on mana and HP, and that's what you want as an offlaner, is to always check where the carry is at, because it's kind of irrelevant where the support is as long as you have full HP. You just have to know where the Slardar is at all times, and he knows that the Slardar has no mana, he doesn't have any more HP left. You've got an Enchanted Mango, but if you run into two, that's actually three Ion Shield creeps, you probably just die.
Yeah. Pasha does have his bottle coming in, which I guess is one of the ways, like, Slardar, it does have some mana issues, so you can kind of see where he's going with that one, plus the regen is helpful, but no one in the middle lane. They will be able to get the stomp, the turnaround, three-man stun, beautiful setup from no one. That will stop a lot of that incoming damage, and the rotation from Secret, not really successful, but they're going to continue on. We've seen this before from Secret. Do they actually try and help out Misery in that offlane? He's going to surge up. They do have vision. Glimpse right back in. Doesn't actually hit the kinetic field, but Pasha is still enough movement speed to catch back up to Misery, and they will get the right click to secure the kill.
Yeah, and they're not close by enough, and especially with this ward spotting them in, this is a really good ward by Vega. It's a pretty common one, and Secret, as soon as they see the supports run back, they know for a fact that there's a ward there, so they go for the instant D ward. And Vega, I mean, they're sitting pretty right now. Like, they just got the stack done. The Tiny's doing really well in terms of farm. Your offlane Clockwork is struggling, but this is a lane that we expect to struggle. Like, he's not going to do well, but he does pretty well against Windranger in the mid game, because most Windrangers are going to skip the Force Staff, for example, and just go for the right away Aghanim Scepter if they can.
Right. So the lockdown of the cogs, even the damage of the battery salt, can definitely threaten the Windranger pretty well. Solo comes back to the middle lane, healing up no one, who is going to be going for the early set of drums. Pretty normal stat item pickup so far. And I'm sure he's going to be going for the Aghanims this game, right? Just because you do have already that Blink aggressive hero on Slardar, it would feel like maybe too much of an investment into the 15 to 25 minute marker to go for double Blinks.
Yeah, because you can definitely go late game with this type of lineup. You don't necessarily have to all in for the mid game with that Blink Dagger, because at some point it will fall off, and Solo should just be
Shackle right Shot here. Follows, but no one makes sure to separate himself to stomp. He's actually going to land on a Solo. Looks like he's going to be going down, the toss up in the air. That's actually a combo. Solo lives. Weeha looking for the right click. He actually has a power shot ready though. Goes for no one. Focus fire. No one living. Just barely power shot. Secures the kill. Solo is now trying to get his way out, but I don't think he's going to make it. He's got no creeps to tether to anywhere close. And double kill for Weeha. And that's just the supports of Team Secret. So Secret actually come out, despite the fact that they were the ones giving away the kills in the beginning of that fight. They did get the Tiny in exchange, and that makes it all worth it.
Yeah, now they have the top two net worths in the game. That was so huge for Weeha right now, because now he's 3-1. The early game, obviously, he dies early on, but it just feels like he really knows how to recover. That was kind of my big question mark for Weeha as a player is, okay, yeah, he's a good pub player, but when it comes to competitive Dota, if he gets behind early, what is he going to do? But it feels like his rotations so far have been on point, so no issues there so far. And Vega just kind of have to slow down the aggression a little bit and play off the timings a little bit more.
Our Clockwork, Eternal Envy is taking some damage here. Clockwork actually managed to pick up the kill in the Darkseer. They'll get Pylite Eye as well.
Huge rotation from him, because Mag was getting shut out in that top lane, but by getting that double kill, his item timings are actually going to be somewhat decent.
Yeah, they now have the Disruptor with his level 6, so now you have lockdown against the enemy.
Oh, that's actually so huge. Mm-hmm. I didn't even notice.
Yeah, he gets it really early on because he makes the rotation.
We're going to get that kill at
top lane, and yeah, Eternal Levy locks inside the kinetic field just barely. They make sure he stays there with the glimpse back, but that might have actually given an escape for Eternal Levy. Oh, halfway through that blink animation, but the damage is there just in time from Solo.
That was a little bit sloppy. Like, he should have said, I'm glimpsing, but by the time they were doing that,
relocate.
Going for it.
They're going for Wii, and they actually think they can catch him with a toss back right into the Clockwork inside of the battery cell cogs. What a combo from Vega.
Oh, that was sick by Vega. And he tries to leave the Tiny behind in case he has the angle, but unable to do so. But this flat-out aggression, I mean, they're just like, screw it, we're far enough ahead.
Don't tell me. No one looking for a toss?
The toss?
Oh, but he tossed it onto the top Puppy instead. I think he was hoping to be able to get the toss and a Puppy to stop the stomp. But Zol's going to be able to come in, maybe heal up. No one just enough. The ultimate goes out. Turtle Heavy, he can't quite get it. Turnaround time. Toss on a Puppy once again. He goes for the stomp. does land on the disruptor, but Puppy's low enough. Ag is committing for the kill onto Misery at the exact same time. Glimpse back, they get Puppy, and Misery flying catapult right on top of his head will finish him off as well. Blunt force trauma, 11-3 right now, and the fight just continues as Weehan now TP's in. He wants part of the action, but Vega Squadron will use that bit of discipline that we've been talking about. The CIS region known for their aggression, but Vega Squadron in particular is known for coupling that aggression with a lot of discipline and making sure they do back up at the right time.
Honestly, it's even less discipline and more the fact that their team fight execution is excellent. Like the way that they set things up, Mag waiting in the bottom of the river so that they could toss the Windranger on top of him, and they haven't even rotated their starter because they know that he's quite a bit behind the anti-mage. So they're like, okay, you focus on getting your blink dagger, Mag will just be the one to rotate around the map. And that's so surprising how successful this Clockwork has been so far, considering how much he was able to get in the offlane. He barely ekes out any levels or farm, but he still manages to go 4-0 so far.
They have a smoke up. It was actually a 4-man smoke. Tiny does break his and shows himself in this top lane while the other two heroes are going to go hunting. Mag and Sam of the Slayer, they actually have a decent amount of kill power. Pylai died. He's going to be caught here, it looks like. Mag's just going to run him down. They do manage to get the Shackle shot. The Silence goes down, relocate in order to finish off this Crystal Maiden, and maybe even go for more. They got the Glimpse. Weehan's going to be tossed up in the air, and that's the death of him as well. Pylai die. Zol's going to try and run him down with the balls. Meanwhile, farther down, Mag, beautiful set of cogs, has caught the heroes inside. They're out the wall to turn around, perhaps, but the toss is just too much damage. They'll finish off these heroes, and Vega Squadron keep everyone alive. The only hero they haven't hunted down yet is Eternal Envy.
This tiny Wisp Disruptor has just completely destroyed Team Secret. Like, Seema the Slayer getting that early level 6, going to that top lane, disrupting that anti-mage's farm, picking up the kill, and then from there, that's a level 6 Disruptor at like 8 minutes into the game, on top of a tiny Wisp that has been so successful throughout. They get their first relocate gank off, it's successful. Mag starts the game 4-0, obviously. He's got a Blade Mail completed at 12 minutes too. You've got Blink Daggers on the heroes that you need them on, and this is going to be a big defense for Team Secret because they need this one to be successful.
Yeah, no one with a Shackle shot on him. Maybe they can commit to the kill. Eternal Levy, he has his ultimate ready to go, but he has no idea who he really wants to throw it on. Now he's sent back up to the top lane, and he's going to be caught by the blink in as Pasha takes him out. The Echo Stamp just not in time, and Vega Squadron are just running over Team Secret.
As a commentator, it's hard to say. You know, you always want to give the other team the benefit of the doubt and say, okay, they can maybe make a comeback, but a kill a minute so far by Vega, it doesn't feel like they're going to stop this aggression either. For Secret to get back into this game, though, you have to secure some stable farm for Eternal Envy, slow down the pace of the game. Going for that tier 1 defense, when they have that Blink Dagger on the Slardar, and as strong as the Tiny and the Wisp are, you can't get into that fight, even if it looks so good.
Yeah, certainly, and I really feel like this is a textbook example of how to couple the Disruptor with aggression and make the most amount of use of him. I mean, the fact that they were able to move the tiny Wisp around the map, and then they have this offlaner that gets online relatively early, it's just been a playfield for Disruptor constantly, playing aggressively and forcing Team Secret to try and run away, and that's where you always get that extra glimpse pickoff. There's so many situations where I think Vega Squadron are using this Disruptor to its max potential.
Oh, for sure. Like, and that's what, if you were looking at that bottom lane, you're just like, okay, the Slardar is taking a lot of damage from the Ion Shells, but all the Disruptor was doing was saying to himself, all I have to do is wait, get level 6, stack and pull. It doesn't really matter if he's doing poorly, because we'll eventually make space for him back, and that's just trust in your teammates.
They deny the offlane tower. The rest of Vega Squadron are going for that smoke gank, but Team Secret, I think they've heard you, Blitz. They're trying to slow down this game. They know that Vega Squadron are just continue to play super aggressively. That's why they're sitting back right now while Vega Squadron are off map.
It's honestly hard as a team to kind of anticipate this amount of aggression. Team Secret probably thinks, okay, the onslaught will finally stop. We can slow down the pace of this game. We'll defend this tier 1 tower, but you kind of have to give Vega a little bit more credit because all throughout this tournament, they're willing to bring all their cores in at like the 10-minute mark just to establish dominance over the map.
Tower is under attack. Vega Squadron look like they're going to be setting up on this tier 1 tower pretty soon. Team Secret not doing Roshan as Vega Squadron may have suspected. They don't really have the most fantastic Rosh taking team. Once they have the medallion, they'll be a lot better. If they can get the Aghanims on Windranger and the medallion on the Elder Titan, then they can do Roshan rather easily. But for now, they can't really go for it.
At this phase of the game, if you go for the Roshan and you lose that fight, the game pretty much just spirals out of control. Yeah. For Secret to continue to be in this game, all they have to do is slow down the pace of the game, create some space for your anti-mage by showing yourself at bottom. So two heroes show themselves at bottom, so then Envy can just kind of free up the jungle for himself and play off of the fact that his team is being really aggressive right now.
This is probably where Wii has to really start using focus fire to threaten these towers, right? Because you need to force rotations, because Vega Squadron right now, they don't really seem too concerned with these heroes at bottom lane. They're controlling the middle lane, they're controlling top at the same time, which means, you know, in a way, they're also controlling the enemy jungle. And they're still taking objectives. It doesn't seem like they really care too much what Team Secret are doing, as long as they're keeping the animage a little bit at bay.
Yeah, for sure. And something you notice too is that people criticize Pylite Dai for dying too much, but this is kind of the style. Is you show yourself as a Crystal Maiden at bottom and say, hey, look at me, come gank me with two, because Vega might think to themselves, okay, somebody has to be behind that Crystal Maiden. You gank the CM with two heroes, and then all of a sudden, Anti-Mage has farm in the top area, he can go to the mid lane, and it's just freeing up space and kind of gathering information for yourself.
So Team Secret at this point in time know they need to actually take a step and make the offensive maneuver, because clearly Vega Squadron are not taking the bait and are just going to stick around at that top lane. So the four-man maneuver is going to come through middle lane. Mag is there, but I'm not sure if that's the highest priority kill at this point. They'll throw out the Shackle Shot and should be able to get this kill to start things off. So Mag does go down for that four-man gank. Disruptor's there with the ultimate, throws it down, doesn't really hit anything. Solo at the same time did complete the relocate, but no one's actually separated there. Pasha's still able to pick up the kill on Pylite Dai towards the end, and no one continues his push at the top lane as Solo returns, not really threatened by Eternal Envy.
I think Secret anticipated that that was probably going to be some sort of one-for-one trade, but again, it's just creating your own pace of game, waiting for the anti-mage to continue to get farm. His Battle Fury timing is actually excellent for this type of game and for how unstable it's been for Team Secret. And going for these little mini skirmishes actually opens up the map. Like, oftentimes people think when you're playing this type of defensive strategy, it's just about everybody hiding on the map. But if that happens, then Vega just takes control of your jungle, they take control of their own jungle, and they out-farm you. Like, somebody has to do something, and somebody has to create space.
Yeah, somebody has to die, essentially, on Team Secret, right? You gotta force something. You know you're behind, but you have to force some sort of action in order to create space, and that's gonna involve one of your supports most likely dying, maybe even one of your cores as well.
This is like a rest in peace Pylite Dai game. He just has to like constantly show himself on the map and hope they go for him. You can't reasonably expect to go for that clockwork kill and not lose somebody because of the relocate.
So this is probably not going to be a Glimmer Cape game for him. Another denied tower, and this is really hurting Team Secret. Two different denied towers now. Vega Squadron holding on to about a 3,000 gold BB. You can see as the things have kind of slowed down, it is going a bit better for Team Secret, no longer climbing in Vega Squadron's favor.
Yeah, this is just what the Anti-Mage does, and same with the Darkseer. Like, the Darkseer is naturally just going to be able to catch up compared to a hero like Clockwork, because the Clockwork has no flash farm mechanic. Like, the Clockwork heavily relies on being able to get kills, participating in team fights to get his net worth. Whereas the Darkseer can just go to the enemy jungle, he can slow down the pace of the game. You've got two supports that are kind of weak, but Puppy's got, you know, he's got the natural order and his stun, so he's always going to be useful without farm. And Pylite Dai is the Crystal Maiden. His farm is kind of irrelevant in this game. All this game is about is making sure that Eternal Envy gets his farm. The Darkseer eventually gets a Blink Dagger.
Oh, do they catch Eternal Envy here? The silence is down, and they just body block him just enough to make sure he stays inside the kinetic field, and the silence pulls on through Vega Squadron. They only get one hero pickoff, but what a hero it was, shutting down Eternal Envy.
Yeah, that was the biggest pickoff that you could have gone on the map. And that was so fortuitous, just because you happen to scout out your jungle, you want to push out that tier 2 bottom anyways. It makes the most sense. And now Vega has two different objectives that they can go for. You can either decide to go for that bottom tier 1 push, which would open up Roshan for you at some point too. Or you can just kind of split up the map and farm. And I think they just go for the bottom tier 1 push, and then you can kind of open up the map a little bit more, go for your own smoke, and then go for the Roshan when you have the Disruptor ult again.
You can see Pasha, because everyone else on his team is essentially bottom, the moment somebody shows himself, he immediately blinks backward. Pylite Dai just kind of threatens him with the Crystal Nova, but he jumps himself away and allows no one to freely take that Tier 1 tower. Team Secret may even have to give up a Tier 2. I like that Vega Squadron are continuing to push for more objectives. Again, this really lessens the control over the Roshan pit in particular, but it also feels like Team Secret are not going to challenge you too much. And as the middle and top lane push out, this will be more farming opportunities for Vega as well. No one, he's not ready to push uphill yet, but he can farm up and complete complete his AC, and maybe then you can see the 5-man push.
Yeah, now that they have so much map control in the game, you've got a level 2 Slardar ultimate that amplify damage just rips through Roshan. It's a medallion plus, and then you've got the Hyperstone completed on No 1-2. And this is going to be the next objective. Once you take down that tier 2 tower at bottom, there's no way that Secret want to take this fight. The Darkseer has a Blink Dagger, so the fight would kind of be okay-ish, but you have no idea how low it is. There's no real way for you to check. You could power shot it, I guess, but even then, what's your initiation here?
So they throw out the spirit, that's all they can really do. And they revealed the fact that, yeah, Roshan's dead. And no one has an Aegis as well as a Hyperstone now. So that AC really not that far away with the BKB on Pasha coming in soon. You look 5 minutes in the future and Vega Squadron are going to be looking so fantastic for teamfights.
Eternal Envy is still going for the Vlads. I think he realizes this is one of those 1v5 AM games where he just has to avoid fights at all times. Going for something like the BKB or something wouldn't make sense. Even going for the Manta, like some people might say, skip the Manta instead of going for the, or go for the Manta instead of going for the Vlad and skip that entirely.
Mm-hmm.
But if you get caught by the Disruptor, what does it actually matter?
Vega Squadron, nice find there. Taking away one of the more aggressive wards from Team Secret laid out earlier.
I think Vega just go for a tier 2 top push, because your bottom lane is pushed in enough, so is your mid lane. And then just try to get aggressive all across the map, and this is a really cool move by them. They're gonna smoke and split up because they know the Tiny Wisp is the obvious target at top. They're like, there's probably heroes behind them, but they're actually just gonna get aggressive and use the relocate. And if they could get the anti-mage here, this would be so huge.
Oh my goodness, he can't be found doing this agent. He's already down to half HP and he's gone.
He's dead.
The relocate comes in, but
the neutral creeps killed him.
Oh, well, that's a little bit lucky for Vega. Oh, that snapback there from the Elder Titan, that was big, but still, it's no one clearing through the whole entire Ancient stack, and that still hurts Eternal Envy so badly. Yeah, they didn't get the kill for that, but he still died in the end. He lost gold, he lost the Ancient stack, a huge blow to Team Secret.
Yeah, getting the anti-mage killed, obviously, you would have liked to have the last hit. Unfortunately, the Ancients took it from you, but it's not too big of a deal because it's more just about the space that you created, and you slow down the anti-mage's split push, which is huge because you don't want to just trade this tier 2 mid for your tier 2 bottom, and if the anti-mage was alive, that would be the choice.
So the tier 2 in mid's definitely going to fall. Vega Squadron can very rapidly rotate up to the top lane, and in fact, they actually have the AC now. Do they have enough time with this Aegis to actually push uphill? Do you think that's on them, that they should be trying to push uphill so early into the game? Misery's gonna be caught by Mag. Great pickup there with the Blade Mail doing its work. But yeah, do you think that they should try and push uphill with this Aegis? Or do you think that they're controlling the game so well they just take all the tier 1s and tier 2s and just play for more farm efficiency, essentially?
If Envy hadn't died there and he was somewhat close to the Manta and he was able to push down that bottom tower, I would say that Vega kind of has to focus more on killing him and then just immediately go for the high ground. But when you already got him killed, you took that tier 2, you're still getting kills around the map, and you've taken complete control of the jungle, I don't think it's as necessary to be that forceful. You can just kind of take control of the map further, slowly choke out Team Secret, and then go for that one death push where Secret just don't have anything in the tank.
Yeah, especially with Wiz Tiny already being so good at split pushing, and they're not all of the net worth of Vega Squadron. I mean, the Slardar as well as the Clockwork are still plenty strong. They can afford to have three of them push in and top lane while Tiny and Wisp make sure that there is no anti-mage split push all the meanwhile.
I mean, the Slardar just built perfectly. Like, he's got the BKB second item because he realizes, I'm not the damage dealer in this team. Mm-hmm. I just need the amplified damage off on a core target, and then the Tiny can kind of mop up. And if you look at the lineup for Team Secret, what actually stops Pasha from just going in?
Yeah, it's really not going to be anything. They need some sort of initiation, but that's not going to come without a Blink Dagger on Windranger. Is that the next item, or do you think he has to go for more damage at this point?
I almost feel like he just needs a BKB to actually get damage off, because as soon as he gets stunned, he's pretty much dead. Win run or no win run, like,
yeah,
they'll chase you down. And Vega, they've got all the core items that they need. You've got the BKB on the Slardar, the Tiny's got his fully completed AC, you've got a mech completed on solo too, and the Aegis has enough timing on it that you can at least take down this tower and go for more.
Oh, the hook shot in, if they could actually stop Puppy from getting off his ultimate, there's gonna be no vacuum combo as well. Misery's gonna be able to get off just the vacuum on one, but that doesn't mean much. Puppy now throws out the ultimate, but he's gonna be going down to Pasha in a second. Three heroes down and three heroes buyback is now. Fourth comes in from Puppy as well. This is Team Secret knowing this is kind of all in for them. They're going to go for Mac to start with, who's so far forward, but now a two-man's done. Pasha finds his opening, goes straight for Wii, who's going to be forced to win run back to the base. Toss in, not quite enough damage, and Pasha won't be able to get that one. No one's quite low, but that's just the Aegis. In fact, he may even die. Illusion, oh, there goes the Wiz. He's gone, and they're going to catch a couple more. Mag manages to push back Eternal Envy, tries to blink himself out and TP away, but that doesn't happen. No one now has to turn. He's surrounded by Team Secret on all sides, just has to try and get as many kills as possible, but a great Shackle shot from Wii is going to be able to ensure the kill, or maybe not. Pasha actually gets a nice stun in. Eternal Envy on the chase, but no one's still incredibly dangerous with this next combination up. Whoever jumps forward and challenges him is just going to be comboed nice and quick. Pasha, he's going to make the turnaround here, looking for some sort of blink, but a Shackle shot. He's going to get the stun onto Wii, but they've kited it around Vega Squadron just perfectly enough that they will wipe them here, and Team Secret will hold.
It took them like 9 different lives, but they still managed to hold. And that's what matters, is that you didn't lose Rex. Your anti-mage got a ton of money for being in that fight. Like, take a look at Eternal Envy's gold bank now. He's got 4,600 gold. I don't think he was the one that had to buy back, right? It was just everybody else on his team. And, I mean, they're pretty poor right now, but again, we talked about it before. If this game goes that badly, it's pretty much going to have to be on the anti-mage anyways.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like the buybacks are definitely worth it when I'm looking at this fight recap, and it's only the Tiny and the Slaughter that are dead, and the gold swing from just those heroes going down is over 4k. So, yeah, it cost them 4 different buybacks, but they definitely did get the kills to make it worth it. And as you said, now Eternal Envy, he's already got that full-out Manta. Looks like they're gonna try and force something. Oh, the hookshot! Matt got him! Eternal Envy stuck here for a full second. He blinks up. Do they have any sort of extra play? Oh, the force tap. He ends up on the wrong side of the cliff, but oh, he managed to actually force it back down. Eternal Envy managed to get the heal from Misery. Looks like that'll keep him alive.
That was so close. If Mag actually hadn't 360'd over that cliff, maybe he probably would have killed him. Like, 2 right clicks would have done it.
Yeah.
Like, the mech makes it look a lot worse than it was, but they were so close to being able to get that kill. The question for Secret now is, what do you do when the next Roshan hits? Because it's going to come with a BKB Tiny, an Aegis, and I don't even know if you can really afford to give up the Aegis, because it took, what, like eight lives or something like that, on top of just to kill like the Aegis, and then the Tiny kind of misplayed it?
Yeah.
Like, you can't anticipate that happening twice.
And we're also talking about, like, we keep on thinking, okay, Secret just need to stall the game, push it. But if you look further in the future, right, it's not like once they push past, you know, 40 minutes, all of a sudden they're good. Because then they have this other side of the window where Tiny Wisp as a late game duo is insanely strong. And Slardar is actually really decent semi-carry now with that amplified damage being buffed up so many times. Now minus 20 armor, so late into the game, that's actually still an incredibly powerful ultimate.
And Pasha, he's going to go for the armlet right now. Just some cheap damage sources and
glimpse. Oh, looks like it's not quite in range. Misery is actually going to smoke right in here. Blinks himself away. As he sees there's just too many heroes for him to fight. And they will get the ancient stack. I think Misery really wanted to contest that, especially around such a clutch area where vacuum wall would be very powerful. But looks like the rest of Team Secret have made the call. They're going to sit back and wait for Vega Squadron to push high ground. Or maybe wait out Roshan. Do you think they fight around Roshan? Can they give up that Aegis?
That's the real question right now, because if Secret take that fight outside of their base, they don't have buybacks, and also if they lose that fight and you give up the Aegis, then you might as well just call GG from Secret. Like, there's right. Actually no coming back from that. So the call is whether or not they feel comfortable enough. It's like, okay, do we give up this Rax at top? Do we think we can mount a defense at the next Rax?
Mm-hmm.
Or do we just go all in for the Roshan? And I actually think the call is to go all in for the Roshan and take that fight outside the base. Because I don't think you're going to kill a Tiny with a BKB twice. I actually don't even think it's going to be a very close fight. And you're probably going to lose that top racks anyways, and that'll probably just mean game. So just go for the fight outside the base. You're not going to get that much stronger than you are right now. Mm-hmm. And hope for some kind of really clutch sequence of events to happen with your Elder Titan and your Darkseer.
Yeah, Elder Titan actually has a big upgrade coming in. His upgrade to the Medallion is coming up, Solar Crest.
You forgot for a second, Caps.
New items. Armlet now complete for Pasha, so he's actually a tanky beast, and it's really hard.
It's just such a good cheap damage item for him.
Mm-hmm. Very mid-game focus, but that's what Slardar's all about.
Yeah, he doesn't really need much more, and this pickup by no one is actually just gonna ruin Seeker right now. He gets the value Talisman of Evasion against Eternal Envy, who's never gonna have an MKB. Same with the Windranger, who has just 400 gold to her name right now.
Yeah, he did go for the Blink Dagger, I guess feeling that the pressure that he has to get those Shackle Shot openings.
Yeah, I guess I agree, but it just comes down to then Secret have to start the fights, and look, this is what they're going for, because they realize at the same time, you can't just give up the Roshan. You have to take the fight outside the base and hopefully win this fight. You're not going to win one against Double Life Tiny, so might as well just make this the fight.
Four-man smoke up, following Eternal Envy. Roshan is up, and Mag's just kind of hanging around this area. I'm sure he's going to throw a rocket into the pit soon just to make sure that Secret haven't snuck in there.
They know for sure about the smoke now.
They're going to come over. The Shackle Shot actually misses, and Weeha's going to be stunned. Let's get a safety force step, but now he's going to be comboed up by Mag. They toss him inside of the cogs. Two-man with the Static Storm on top. They don't stand a chance. Double BKBs being used by Vega, but it's well worth it because Secret do not have buyback on those heroes.
Yeah, and I think you actually just walk into the Rosh Pit because they're so preoccupied with the illusions, but the Radiant Courier was sniped by Eternal Envy, and now this is panic mode for Eternal Envy. He has to go for the split push mid and just trust that they're going to go for the Roshan instead of him. There's no sneaky smoke plays or anything like that, and they're going to give up the Aegis, but this is kind of what you expected as a result, right? If you're not going to win that fight, you're giving up the Aegis, and this is probably going to mean a minimum of Arrakis.
Mm-hmm. So Eternal Envy is essentially trying to buy time by split pushing out as hard as humanly possible, making it so Vega Squadron have to kind of recover these lanes. Maybe he just gives them an extra minute, but one more minute of farming could be a completed big time item for the Animage. But what does he go? Like 3,500 gold to sell? Jump in, and they're going to be relocated on toss combo. Bye bye, Eternal Envy. So forget about that 3k gold.
He has a lot of it left over. Like, he's got 1800 on top of the buyback.
But so much lost farming time. It feels like he's like, if it's butterfly, right? I feel like he's not going to be able to complete that butterfly now before Vega Squadron push uphill.
This is the awkward part of the game where you ask me, okay, what should they go for? But there's like three different items that Eternal Envy needs.
Yeah. Puppy's dead. Hook shot, combo. Well, all right. The Solar Crest makes it a little bit more difficult, but you realize they'll have to actually use spells for it.
Yeah, and Weeha's just going to push in mid as fast as he can because he realizes, all right, without our Elder Titan, this is going to be a pretty hard defense, but he eventually is going to have to TP back after this wave. Maybe you just accept the fact that you're going to lose your racks here.
Yeah.
They're just going to head to mid right after.
So that could be not only the top lane racks as well as maybe tier 3 before Animage naturally revives. I mean, he just does not want to buy back. He's already suffering so badly.
Yeah, they're going to take this Rax, immediately go for that mid lane, and just force Secret into another like 8-man defense. But this time around, unfortunately, Secret doesn't have any buybacks available.
Alright, tier 3 gone. Melee Rax going to be falling soon. This is going to be the full lane of Rax if Team Secret don't fight until the Elder Titans back up. Need to make the jump in now, but Eternal Envy's already been... and sent back Shackle Shot vacuum right on top of the Wild Blood. Mag has actually interrupted primary damage dealer of Weeha with his hook shot. Now starts getting away while Misery will just pound into dust by no one. Samus Lair trying to catch up will be able to make sure there's no extra jump from Team Secret. Control Shackle Shot, focus fire over the cliff, but Pasha jumps right over that cliff and gets a nice stun onto Weeha. Puppy looking for an echo stomp. They have to catch something here. They can't afford to let Vega Squadron just back up for free. But at the same time, there's still huge turnaround potential for Vega. Eternal Envy has actually found Mag, but oh! Pasha actually jumps and gets another stun. Shackle Shot doesn't latch. Great Disruptor Ultimate that controls two different heroes. That's going to be Weeha as well as Pylai Dai. Dead. Misery instantly stunned up by that extra bit of stun from Craggy Exterior. Samus Lair going to be caught. Stomp up. Taz. Whoa! Right before the relocate gets Tiny the hell out of there, Animage is taught right on top of Darkseer.
That's like the saddest death ever, because Eternal Envy's like, I don't want to do this to you.
I'm so sorry.
And he just flies on top of him, but that wasn't the worst fight in the world for Team Secret. Like, they repelled them, even with the Aegis available, he didn't lose it, but at the same time, they were able to just hold on for a little bit longer. I kind of agree with the choice of giving up the Rax, because you want your full, you want to at least do one full-on team fight if you're Team Secret. Like, why go out, you know, in a 3v5 fight where people filter in one by one? I actually felt like that was IG's weakness. Like, get one really strong fight, continue to rely on the fact that Eternal Envy can still win this game for you. Like, he can still play the split-pushing Anti-Mage, but He just needs so many different items now.
Yeah. The completed Battle Fury is there. Or, sorry, Butterfly for the Tiny. And he's still got another 2,600 gold on top of that solo. Picked up the Glimmer Cape, which we saw a nice little nifty escape there earlier after he was relocated back. Glimmer and TP out.
Vega, they're gonna assemble again.
Okay.
Oh.
I mean, we've seen this story before with Eternal Envy.
Okay,
this is him attempting to make some sort of excellent trade, or... I mean, the last time I saw this pickup, specifically Divine Rapier with Eternal Envy, he was actually able to utilize it to beautifully split push and trade racks for racks.
You know what this has to happen? You know what has to happen? They actually have to just surprise them with this Divine Rapier, and Eternal Envy just has to, like, come in, hit like a freight train, and then all of a sudden Vega understands, they're like, oh, we actually can't take this fight. And that's what he's doing right now. Like, you notice he's hidden in the back, because he doesn't want to tip off Vega to the plan, because if Vega sees it, all they're going to do is all in no matter what, but it might not matter.
Puppy gets jumped by the hookshot, but they do manage to get him out there with the four staff.
Oh, Weeha's actually spotted out.
Oh,
he doesn't have
no!
Either.
He can't afford to go down here. He gets a wind run trying to buy some time, but he's going to be glimpsed, tossed, avalanche, and he's gone. No buyback for 70 seconds, and now the plan already. Oh, it's going to look even worse with Misery now jumped by another hookshot. Mag is just on point here. Cox pushed back over
like
and over again. They managed to get the stun onto Eternal Envy while they have their offlaner Darks here already dead. They're going to hit the chain stun onto Eternal Envy as well. The Divine Rapier is on the deck, and Team Secret don't have a hope, don't have a prayer in this game one. Vega Squadron coming on strong in this best of three.
I mean, this looked like every one of Vega's wins, just dominant from minute one. It just felt like the individual mistakes added up too much, giving up that solo kill at bottom and then getting glimpsed back. That allowed their disruptor to get that really quick six, being able to get that solo kill in mid lane between the Tiny and the Wisp. It just feels like Vega understands how all their lanes are